In this video, we are going to look at an intriguing problem in probability called Buffon's needle problem. I like this exercise because it combines elements of probability, geometry, and calculus. I'm going to try to present what I think is the simplest way to understand this problem, and the only calculus skill that you need is just a basic integral. So in particular, we are going to estimate the value of pi using just the notion of the average value of a function. Before we get there, let's talk about what Buffon's needle problem actually is. This problem was named after Georges-Louis Leclerc, Comte de Buffon. And what we want to imagine him doing is throwing needles onto a floor consisting of parallel lines. So imagine that these are perhaps horizontal tiles and the spacing between them is D. He throws a needle onto the floor of some length L. Traditionally, you treat L as smaller than D, but that's not actually necessary and we'll consider both cases. So we can treat these numbers L and D like parameters in an experiment. The question we aim to answer is, what is the probability that this needle will cross one of the lines on the floor? And as we will see, that is actually related to the value of pi. So this particular needle did not cross the floor, but this next one does. Let me drop a few more. Here are some assumptions we need to make with this experiment. All of these needles were dropped randomly. And then how many needles crossed the lines only depends on each one's position relative to the closest lines. So as we start to model this experiment, we can simplify our domain. I don't need all of these parallel lines if I imagine all of the needles fell between this pair. So in running this experiment, we could do a vertical translation where we imagine sliding all of the needles to sit between the same pair of lines. That simplifies our domain vertically, and then we can also simplify it horizontally if we wanted to, by just imagining that we're throwing in some small domain. So this configuration is equivalent to my original one. All right, let's zoom in. With a large number of needles, the ratio of the number of crossings to the total number of needles is approximately the probability of landing a single needle on the line. If you did not have that probability, then you could do this with the large number of needles in order to estimate the probability. Let's say more, though, about what this probability of landing a single needle on the lines is. What a lot of presentations do is they imagine that the lines on the floor are fixed, and then they try to compute how the needle could land on one of the lines. But this is a hard problem, and I'm going to simplify it. First, let me show you why it's hard. There are really two aspects of how the needle lands that one would have to consider when the floor is fixed. The first aspect is, where is the needle situated vertically? So this needle is not crossing these lines, but this needle is. So you would need some way of measuring up and down where the needle lands. The other aspect to consider is how rotated the needle is. So while this needle is crossing, this one at a different angle is not. That makes this problem hard. You have to figure out vertically where the needle lands and how rotated it is. I would like to present a simpler approach. Instead of throwing the needle at the lines, I would like to throw the lines at the needle. So what is the probability of landing a line on this needle? To make sense of this, imagine that the entire domain is the strip between the two dotted lines. There is nothing above or below these dotted lines. If I throw a horizontal line and I land it above the top of the domain, it would just get mapped down here. On the flip side, anything that lands below the lower line would get mapped up here. So the highlighted band we're looking at right now, you could imagine as splitting that into two so that the entire domain consists only of what's between the dotted lines. If you've studied topology, you'll recognize that the domain I'm trying to describe is actually a cylinder. Okay, but I don't want to go down that road and overcomplicate the situation. I'm going to throw horizontal lines between these two bands. The needle is fixed. This horizontal line is not crossing, but this one is. So that would represent a crossing. This horizontal line is not crossing. And just to make the domain clear, this horizontal line would be the same as this one. You might wonder if it matters which needle I chose. For example, for this blue needle, I chose one which was not originally crossing. It doesn't matter, but let me illustrate that with this originally crossing needle. If I wanted to compute the probability of landing a line on this needle, what I would do is first break it into two pieces, so that what was above the top line gets mapped down to the bottom line. That way our needle stays within the domain. But trying to land a horizontal line on either of these two pieces is equivalent to shifting our entire domain up and trying to land a horizontal line on this intact needle. The geometric probability will be the same. The beauty of this argument is that we no longer care about the up or down position of the needle. So I'm taking away that first aspect of how the needle falls. From this moment forwards, we only are concerned with how rotated the needle is because that affects how likely we are to throw a line on it. So we've reduced the number of variables to consider. Okay, let's actually compute some probability now. We're going to work with case one, the more typical case, and that is to assume that the length of the needle L is less than or equal to the spacing between the lines D. If you don't see right away why that matters, you will when we move on to case two. So what is the probability that if I threw a horizontal line onto this domain, I would cross this needle? That's the probability of throwing a horizontal line onto this green zone. So when you compute a probability, it's the ratio of when the event occurs to all total events, or what I like to think of as good divided by all. In this configuration, good is the height of the green zone. I'm going to name that Y. And all is the height of the entire domain. That's what we're calling D. We realize that Y is affected by the angle of rotation of the needle relative to the horizontal. So let me label this diagram. The length of the needle L is fixed. Theta depends on how the needle fell. And the height Y of the green zone is affected by that angle. From geometry, we know that sine of theta is y over L, which means that we can solve for y in terms of the fixed number L and the angle theta. In particular, y is L sine theta. Therefore, the probability of landing a line on this needle is the length of the needle L times sine of the angle it makes with the horizontal theta divided by the domain's width D. Again, we only have to care about how rotated our angles are. We no longer have to care about where they land vertically on the domain. For this needle, the probability is still L sine of theta divided by D, but the angle theta is different. You can see that a more vertical angle, an angle closer to 90 degrees, increases the probability. All possible rotations are going to fall between 0 and 90 degrees, or pi over 2. And since all of the needles will be thrown randomly, all angles are equally likely. What that means is that the probability of landing a line on the needle, which is equivalent to the probability of landing a needle on the lines, is just now a function of the angle. So as a function of the angle theta, it's L sine of theta divided by D. Returning to our original question, what is the probability of landing a needle on the lines? Since all angles are equally likely, that's like asking what is the average value of P of theta? So averaged out across all angles, what would we expect P of theta to return us? From single variable calculus, we can do an average value computation. It's 1 divided by the width of the domain for theta, so that's pi over 2 minus 0, times the integral from 0 to pi over 2 of the function P of theta, L sine of theta divided by D. L and D are just numbers. The antiderivative of sine of theta is negative cosine of theta. So that this average value computation turns into 2L divided by pi times D times negative cosine of pi over 2 minus negative cosine of 0, or plus cosine of 0. Cosine of pi over 2 is 0. Cosine of 0 is 1. Therefore, the sum of those two cosine expressions is just 1. Which tells us that the probability of landing a needle on the lines works out to 2 times L divided by D times pi. Therefore, with enough needles, the ratio of the number of crossings to the number of needles should approximate this value. You might have forgotten what we're trying to do. If we can compute this explicit probability, why do we even need to simulate it with an experiment? What we're actually trying to do is approximate pi. So with an experiment, we could actually throw a bunch of needles, tally up how many cross the lines, divide it by the number of needles, and that should approximate 2L divided by D times pi, where presumably we know L and D. Therefore, we can solve for pi and say that pi should be approximately 2 times L times the total number of needles divided by D times the total number of crossings. You might notice there's one particular ratio of L to D which would be most convenient. So if the length of your needles is half of the line spacing D, then 2L is D, which means that pi is approximately the number of needles divided by the number of crossings. While the theory is nice, in practice, it's not that easy to get close to a good value for pi. with this ratio at the bottom, you'll recognize that the number of needles divided by the number of crossings is always going to be a rational number, whereas pi is irrational. For example, if you had 10 needles and you threw them at the floor, the best you're going to get would be like 10 divided by maybe 3 to give you 3.33 is your approximation for pi. Before we move on to case 2, let me just run for you a simulation I wrote in MATLAB. In this particular simulation, I'm going to make this assumption for simplicity that the length of the needles is half of the spacing. And I ran this several times, and this was the closest one I got to pi. Let's take a quick look at the second case, which is that your needles are really long relative to the spacing on the floor. You can check at the end that the two cases do agree when L equals D, so this inequality here doesn't have to be strict. To see why this case is different, let me take one of these needles and slide it down to the very bottom of the domain. Our approach will still be the same, which is that we want to imagine this needle is fixed and I'm going to throw lines on it. But before we do that, let's make an observation. And that is that if this needle is just above that bottom line, if I start to rotate it, eventually we arrive at some critical angle beyond which, no matter how the needle is situated vertically, we must have a crossing. Therefore, when we start to put together our probability function, we should have a function that says that the probability is 1 for all angles at or above this critical angle. If the needle isn't that rotated, so for a smaller angle, then the configuration is still the same. So for the second angle on the bottom, which is opening up a smaller angle with the horizontal, we still want to consider the ratio of this vertical height y to the entire domain D, and it's the exact same computation as before. So for all angles theta smaller than the critical angle, the probability is still L times sine of theta divided by D. Putting these two situations together, we realize we have a piecewise defined function. The domain for theta is still from 0 to pi over 2, but what we're going to do is follow the sine wave, L divided by D times sine of theta, up to the critical angle. And then beyond that, the probability will flatten off at 1. You can't have a probability greater than 1. So these two curves intersect right at the critical angle. Therefore, the only difference between this computation and the previous case is that our probability function is piecewise defined. The next mathematical principle is still the same, though, which is that we want to average out this function across all possible angles of theta, and all angles are still equally likely. Because our function is piecewise defined, though, we will need to break up our computation at the critical angle, so let's make a few algebraic remarks about what happens at that intersection point. The first observation I want to make is that we can actually compute what that critical angle is in terms of d and l. Notably, it's the arcsine of d divided by l. If you plug that into the sine function, you'll get L over D times D over L, giving us a probability of 1 right at that critical angle. And then when we work through the computation, we will need to compute the cosine of the critical angle. Using the Pythagorean theorem, we can say that that's the square root of 1 minus the sine of that angle squared. But since the sine of the critical angle is just D over L, cosine of the critical angle will be the square root of 1 minus the ratio D over L squared. Okay, so we're ready. Were we to do an experiment where we threw long needles on the floor, the number of crossings to the number of needles should be approximately the probability of landing one of those needles on the lines. That's still the average value of the probability function, which we will still compute using calculus techniques. Because our function is piecewise defined, we break up the integration across the critical angle. The entire computation is multiplied out front by 2 over pi, which I've gone ahead and distributed to these two terms. Again, the antiderivative of sine of theta is negative cosine of theta. We can plug in the top and bottom bounds. This time, the top bound is the critical angle. The bottom bound is still 0. Then for our second integral, we're just antidifferentiating 1. Plugging in the top and bottom bounds will give us pi over 2 minus the critical angle. At this point, we're essentially done. I just want to put the final answer entirely in terms of the experiment's parameters. That's the distance d and the length l. We worked out what cosine of the critical angle was, so you'll see I made that replacement in the first parentheses. Likewise, we know that the critical angle itself is arcsine of d over l. So we have the ratio of the number of crossings to the total number of needles is approximately 2 times the needle length divided by d times pi times the expression 1 minus the square root of 1 minus the ratio of d over l squared plus 1 minus 2 over pi times arcsine of d over l. It's a little less satisfying than the first result. I'll leave it to you as an exercise to work out that when l equals d, this actually does simplify to the first case's expression. Our goal is still to approximate pi, so I'm going to solve for pi here. That's just some algebra, but before I do that, let me just make some simplifications. I'm going to call the ratio on the left crossings to total. And then I want to recognize that the square root of 1 minus the ratio d over l squared can be written as the square root of l squared minus d squared all over l. Now we can isolate pi. It doesn't look as nice as for case 1, so that's why people like case 1 better. But if your needles are long and you throw a bunch of them on a floor whose spacing is shorter, you could use this formula to approximate pi. I'll leave you with a MATLAB movie doing that.